Beautiful. Now, I want you to add that one to your repertoire, Steve. I want to hear that one again. That was beautiful. Wow. How much grace does God have? We sing about His amazing grace. The Bible tells us that He gives us grace. But how much grace? Grace is God's undeserved favor. Grace is the reason God sent Jonah to that wicked city of Nineveh to preach there. And when they repented, God spared the city. That's grace. Grace is the reason God forgives us, even when we fail Him so many times. Grace is the reason God gives us opportunities to serve Him even when we fall, even when we mess up our lives. God can restore us. That's grace. And grace is the reason that Jesus came and died on the cross for our sins so that we could be forgiven. Grace is the kindness that God shows us, especially when we don't deserve it. That's grace. When Billy Graham, I heard this story about Billy Graham. And I love Billy Graham, don't you? I mean, he's just, what a great man of God. And when Billy Graham was driving to a small southern town, he was stopped by a policeman in charge of speeding. Well, Billy Graham admitted his guilt, but was told by the officer he was going to have to appear in court. The judge asked, "Guilty or not guilty?" And Billy Graham pleaded guilty. The judge looked at him and he said, "Aren't you Billy Graham?" And he recognized that this powerful, famous, godly man had come through his town and was standing right there in front of him in that courtroom. And the judge said, "Well, that'll be $10, a dollar for every mile you went over the limit. You have violated the law. The fine must be paid. Dr. Graham, I'm going to pay the fine for you." And he took a $10 bill out of his own wallet and he attached it to the ticket. And then he took Billy Graham to lunch. That bought him steak dinner. "That," said Billy Graham, "is how God treats repentant sinners. That's called grace." You know, we deserve punishment when we sin against God, and let's face it, the Bible says, "For all have sinned and fall short of God's glory," and it seems to me like we're prone to sin and we mess up over and over again. We really do offend God when we sin against Him, but God forgives us when we confess our sin and when we repent of our sins. God forgives us, He restores our fellowship with Him, and He blesses us. Now just think of how many times the Almighty and Holy God has looked at you with eyes of love and has helped you through life and difficult circumstances, when Satan would want to bind you, when he would want to trap you and enslave you. I'm sure all of us could say, we cried out to the Lord and He heard our cry and He took us up out of the miry clay, out of a horrible pit, and He set our feet upon a rock, as the psalmist said. We could all say, "It's amazing grace. The Lord has been good to me." That's grace. And when God, in the Old Testament, sent Moses to Egypt to warn Pharaoh of impending judgment, that's grace. How would Pharaoh respond? Well, this is what we're going to look at this morning in the scripture passage from Exodus chapter 9. When God could have killed Pharaoh and all of Egypt, He didn't. Instead, He warned him. That's called grace. Grace is at the heart of all God's dealings with man, and it is the reason God still hears and answers us today. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, blind, but now I see. It's because of His grace, and we're even going to see God's grace in the dark story of these plagues in Egypt, and we're going to look at it today from Exodus 9 as I continue the message that, series that I have begun called Creating for His Glory. And I'm going to ask Andrew Lovett, one of my youngest son and one of our fine young men in Calvary, if he would come and read this scripture for us. Would you stand with me as we honor the reading of God's precious and holy word?
Beginning in verse 13. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say to him, 'Thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. For at this time I will send all my plagues to your very heart and on your servants and on your people, that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth.' Now if I had stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, then you would have been cut off from the earth. But indeed, for this purpose I have raised you up, that I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. As yet you exalt yourself against my people, and that you will not let them go. Behold, tomorrow about this time I will cause very heavy hail to rain down, such as not been in Egypt since its founding until now. Therefore send now and gather your livestock and all that you have in the field, for the hail shall come down on every man and every animal which is found in the field and is not brought home, and they shall die. He who feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his livestock flee to the houses. But he who did not regard the word of the Lord left his servants and his livestock in the field. Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand toward heaven, that there may be hail in all the land of Egypt, on man, on beast, and every herb of the field, throughout the land of Egypt. And Moses stretched out his rod toward heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail, and fire darted to the ground. And the Lord rained hail on the land of Egypt. So there was hail and fire mingled with the hail, so very heavy that there was none like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation. And the hail struck throughout the whole land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast. And the hail struck every herb of the field and broke every tree of the field. Only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, there was no hail." Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, and thank you for your grace on us, the grace that we obey you, and you reward us for that. I pray that we'll be witnesses to people who don't believe in you and who don't believe in your grace, and help us to show your love to them through all our actions, and help us to learn more about that through this lesson today. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Created for His glory. Well, as we've been studying God's purposes for His people, we have seen that above all else, God's purpose for us is to know Him and make Him known. So if I were to ask you today, what is God's ultimate purpose for us? What would it be? To know Him and make Him known. Let's say it together. To know Him and make Him known. That's God's purpose. We were created for His glory. And as people created for His glory, we know that God guides us into His purposes. His gifts for us are for His purposes. And God guards His people from peril. So that's how God is working in the children of Israel. He is going to deliver them. So first He brings Moses into His presence. He gives Moses everything he needs. Moses is 40 years old when he left Egypt. As a fugitive from the law, from Pharaoh's justice, he goes into the wilderness. He meets God at the burning bush, standing on holy ground. He meets God, and God does a supernatural work of grace in his heart. He brings him to himself. He says, "Moses, wherever I'm at, that's holy ground. Friend, wherever you are, wherever God is with you, that's holy ground. We need to remember who's with us always." Sometimes we forget, don't we? We don't think about the fact that the Lord is with us wherever we go and whatever we do. When we're saying those things that we shouldn't say, let's remember that. When we're going to places we shouldn't go, let's remember that. When we're deciding to do our own thing instead of God's thing, let's remember He is there with us. He's there, and it's holy ground, and we should remember that. So God gifts Moses. He guides him into His presence. He gifts him for His purposes. And He gives Moses everything he needs to return. And at 80 years old, Moses makes this trek back across the desert into Egypt. And he goes and he stands before the Pharaoh. And then we see how, standing before the most powerful man on earth, a man that could say, I don't want to hear what you have to say. The son put him to death. A man who has that kind of power. Pharaoh couldn't touch him. You know why? Because God guards us from peril. See, when we are following the purposes of God and we know the Lord as our Savior, when we have come to know Him, then God guards us from peril. Now, as we think about how God guards His people, God guards us with the display of His power. And when God displays His power, it is to reveal His sovereignty. It is in this display of God's sovereignty that we see Moses standing before Pharaoh, delivering the message of God. It is a display of God's sovereignty that we see in all the plagues that He's poured out on Egypt. Down in Egypt, the children of Israel were slaves. They cried out to God for 400 years. And God raised up this man, Moses, to deliver them. Moses was God's instrument to deliver His word to the Pharaoh of Egypt. And this was the word God wanted Moses to deliver. Let my people go, that they may serve me. But Pharaoh did not listen to God. He said, I do not know the Lord, and I will not let this people go. So God sent a series of plagues upon Pharaoh in Egypt. And we've already seen six of those plagues. The first three plagues revealed the identity of the sovereign God. The next three plagues revealed the omnipresence of the sovereign God. We've looked at those. The last three plagues reveal the omnipotence of the sovereign God. And that's what we're going to see today. After all that God has done to convince Pharaoh to release the children of Israel, Pharaoh is still defiant. God has turned the Nile River to blood. God has sent flies, gnats, frogs, even diseases upon Egypt. And in each case, Pharaoh says, okay, Moses, I've had enough. Your people can go. Can you imagine that? All these things came upon the land. And the Pharaoh each time says, okay, go ahead. I'm convinced. They can go. But then he changes his mind and he will not let them go. It is a dangerous thing. Listen, it is a dangerous thing to try to play games with Almighty God. And so in Exodus 9, we see the beginning of the end of Pharaoh's defiance. The Lord God makes His omnipotence very clear to Pharaoh. Remember how in the first plagues, Pharaoh ordered his magicians to duplicate the plagues and thus show that he had just as much power as the Hebrew God? Well, here, God says to Pharaoh, enough's enough. In Exodus 9, God tells Pharaoh that He is going to unleash all His judgment on him and the people of Egypt. And God begins this round with a miracle that God makes personal. It is the seventh plague. It is fiery hail. And we see it in verses 13 and 14 as Moses stands before Pharaoh. Notice what he says. Then the Lord said to Moses, rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, let my people go, that they may serve me. For at this time I will send all my plagues to your very heart and on your servants and on your people, that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. God has made this personal. I want you to notice again what God said. I will send all my plagues on you, on your servants, on your people, so that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. God created us for His glory. Our purpose is to know God and make Him known. That's not just God's purpose for us in this church building. It is God's purpose for every person to know Him and make Him known. You see, God made us in His image. That's personal. God gave us His word. That's personal. God created us with uniqueness. There is no one exactly like you in all the earth. That's personal. And God designed a life purpose for you. That is personal. So Somewhere man forgot that. And the majority of people in this world have forgotten that. But somewhere we have to get back to being personal with God. Salvation is not a private thing. Salvation is a personal thing. God calls us personally. God draws us personally. God saves us personally. God sends us personally. It's not private because we're all commissioned to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Peter said in 1 Peter 3:15, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. Set God apart. Listen, make God the center of all you do. That's what Peter said. Sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be ready always to give an answer to everyone who asks you a reason of the hope in you with meekness and fear. Jesus said, go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how He has had compassion on you. Does that sound private? No. Like Moses, we are to proclaim the word of the Lord. We are to make Him known to others. That was God's purpose even for Pharaoh, who was stuck in false worship, worshiping the other gods, the false gods of Egypt. God made it personal. And God said to Pharaoh, I am going to make myself known so that you will know that there is none like me in all the earth. And that's exactly what this man needed. He had to be shown. When I was young, I used to hear my dad say this to me, and I, who was a little bit stubborn anyway, he would say, people who can't listen have to learn. You ever heard that? People who can't listen have to learn. Well, that's what we see here. The man who held captive 1 million of God's people, who thought himself to be so big that he could defy the living God, he was going to be brought down by the highest authority so that he would know without a doubt that there is none like God in all the earth. Now, what we learn from these last three plagues is that only Almighty God has the power to save the lost. Only God can save. Look at verse 15 through 17. Now, God said, if I have stretched out my hand and struck you and your people, talking to Pharaoh now, if I had stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, then you would have been cut off from the earth. But indeed, for this purpose I have raised you up, that I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. As yet you exalt yourself against my people, and that you will not let them go. See, God tells Pharaoh that he could have killed him. It would have been an easy thing for God to kill Pharaoh. He could have just killed him. God could have destroyed the whole nation of Egypt. He could have. But God chose instead to use him for His purposes. Can God use lost people? Can God use wicked people, infidels, for His glory? Of course He can. God can do anything. And while Pharaoh thought he was in charge, that he was calling the shots, God was laughing at him. Now I say that, but really God was not laughing. In fact, His heart breaks whenever there are those who reject Him. God could have killed Pharaoh, but He chose instead to offer him grace. He gave him opportunity after opportunity to repent and obey Him. But Pharaoh refused God. And anytime we refuse God, the result will not be harm to God, it's harm to us. God acted as He always has. God acted in grace. God never changes. He never changes in His love. He never changes in His purpose. He never changes in His power. God gave a warning to Pharaoh and the Egyptians, not because He had to, but because He's a God of grace. Verses 18 to 19. Behold, tomorrow, God tells Pharaoh, tomorrow I will cause very heavy hail to rain down, such as has not been in Egypt since its founding until now. Therefore, send now. Do you hear? He's not talking to the children of Israel. He's talking to this wicked Pharaoh, this pagan king. He says, I'm going to send hail on this land, something like you've never seen before. So go, send word, and gather your livestock and all that you have in the fields. For the hail shall come down on every man and every animal which is found in the field and is not brought home, and they shall die. Some people, even godly people, believe God has some vendetta against those who are wicked and reject Him. I think God just can't wait to punish evildoers contrary to everything you know about God. Ezekiel 33:11, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked should turn from his way and live. Will God punish evildoers? Oh, you better believe it. Does God hate the sin, even the sin, the immoral sins that's going on in this world today? Oh, yes. He very much does hate that sin. But does God love those who sin? Yes, he does. He loves people. And he wants more than anything for them to turn from their wickedness. Does God love the evil that people do? Oh, no, he hates it. But God loves those people. Same, that's what he wants from us. We are not supposed to tolerate, embrace, encourage, empower those who sin. We are not. We are to do what we can to give the message of God's holiness. Because holy is only four letters, but it is a big, big word. And God has called all men to holiness. So the Lord doesn't want to destroy Egypt. He does not want to destroy Pharaoh. He wants to save them. The seventh plague is evidence of God's love and grace. Although Pharaoh and the Egyptians had rejected God and had ignored his word and warnings, God did not form a grudge against them. He is not a vindictive God. The Lord knows the frailty of man. Friends, God is so great he could crush the earth between his fingers. He doesn't have this personal grudge against sinners. The most powerful man is nothing in the sight of God. God doesn't want to destroy men. He wants to save them. So he warns men, take refuge, judgment's coming. For God so loved the world, he said, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. But, God says, he who believes in Jesus is not condemned. But he who does not believe in Jesus is already condemned. And he's heading for an eternal condemnation because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Only God can save. And God only saves those who hear his word and accept him as their Savior. I've been so disappointed this week, as many of you probably have also, to hear powerful religious people talk about how God is going to save everybody. God is not going to save everybody. Jesus said, wide is the gate, broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be who go in that way. The straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leads to life, and few there be that go in that way. Not everyone's going to heaven. Not everyone's going to be saved. I wish they were. God wishes they were. But God allows men to reject him. And when they reject him, they reject their only hope of eternal life. So only God can save. And God will only save those who hear his word and accept him as their Savior. And although Pharaoh was still refusing God, God heard the cries of those in Egypt who did believe. Notice, some did believe. Look at 20 and 21. So he who feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh made his servants and his livestock flee to the houses. But he who did not regard the word of the Lord left his servants and his livestock in the field. Some believed, didn't they? Some heard the word. Some believed. God loved those Egyptians as much as he loved the Hebrews. He did everything he could to turn their hearts to him and save them. And he does the same today. He paid the ultimate price when Jesus came into this world and shed his blood and died on the cross so that the world through him might be saved. Those who hear and believe find eternal life. But those who refuse to believe will find judgment raining down upon them, just like the hail that fell from the sky. And secondly, we notice from this plague that only Almighty God has the power to overcome nature's laws. Now the Bible says in Psalm 24:1, the earth is the Lord in all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. The Almighty God is the creator of all things. He created the largest galaxies and the smallest atoms. He created everything for his glory, and he can do anything with his creation that he desires. John said, all things were made by him, and without him nothing was made that was made. He created it all. This world did not randomly appear from spinning space dust. It was created. God created it, and he set certain natural laws in place that govern how the earth and life functions. But as the creator God, he has the authority to overcome those natural laws. In Joshua's day, he made the sun stand still. In Hezekiah's day, God made the sun go backward. These are miracles. King Hezekiah was sick, and Hezekiah was a king that loved God. And Hezekiah told Isaiah the prophet, or Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed. He said, God, I've been with you when no one else was with you. I stuck with you. And now I've got a disease and I'm going to die. Isaiah told him that he was going to die and set his house in order. Hezekiah prayed and God said, I'm going to give you 15 more years. And Hezekiah said, that's wonderful. God said, I'm going to give you a sign. Well, Hezekiah said, well, he said, I'm going to make the sundial move 10 degrees. And so, well, Hezekiah said, well, if the sun goes down 10 degrees, that's nothing. He does that all the time. God said, I'm going to make it go backward 10 degrees. Can you imagine in the cosmos what happened for the sun to dial go backward 10 degrees? The earth had to turn backward. It had to stop. Why didn't everything fly off of the earth when that happened? All I know is he took care of it. You see, God can do anything. There's nothing. We have these laws of gravity, you know, that what goes up must come what? Down. It's a natural law. But yet the last thing Jesus did when he was walking on this earth was he ascended into heaven. He flew in that. He did that under his own power. See, here's the thing. God can do anything. Think about the miracles of Jesus. He was born of a virgin. He walked on the water. He calmed the storm by speaking to it. He fed thousands with a few loaves of fish. He kept breaking bread and fish. He kept multiplying. And then Jesus died on the cross and his body was laid in the tomb, and then he brought life back into his body. He raised himself from the dead and proved that all power was in his hand. There is nothing that he cannot do. And when he overcomes the laws of nature and performs a miracle, it's always for the same purpose as the plagues of Egypt. Exodus 9, 14 and 16, that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth, and that I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. See, God would send hail to the earth, frozen water from the sky. Have you ever seen? Anybody here ever seen hail fall from the sky? Sure, we all know fall. Now, rain falling up for Egypt was scarce. In fact, the Delta region around the river received about 10 inches of rainfall each year, but the upper region only received about 1 inch or less per year. That's not much for a year. So for there to be a big hailstorm, that was unusual. But it was not out of the realm of possibility. And yet God did something that had never been done before. Look at verse 22. Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand toward heaven, that there may be hail in all the land of Egypt, on man, on beast, and on every herb of the field, throughout all the land of Egypt. And Moses stretched out his rod toward heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail, and fire darted to the ground. And the Lord rained hail on the land of Egypt, so that there was hail, and fire mingled with the hail, so very heavy that there was none like it in all the land of Egypt, since it became a nation, and the hail struck throughout all the whole land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast, and the hail struck every herb of the field, and broke every tree of the field, only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, there was no hail. Hail in itself is a rare phenomenon, but to have balls of ice, big balls of ice, dropping to the ground and then catching on fire, has anybody ever seen that before? It's unheard of. For ice to ignite is against the laws of nature, but that's exactly what it takes for some people to believe in God, to have to see something that is impossible in order to believe. Well, they saw it. These Egyptians saw it. They saw the ice come down and the fire spring up. They saw the fields catch fire and the crops and animals perish. One commentary I read said, the cattle seem to have been sent out to graze, which is from January to April, when a lone pasturage can be obtained, and accordingly, the cattle were in the fields. The storm occurring at that season not only struck universal terror into the minds of the people, but occasioned the destruction of all people and cattle, which, in neglect of the warning, have been left in the fields as well as all vegetation. See, faith, some people got it, but most people didn't. Pharaoh got the point, though. No one could do these things except God. Verse 27, and Pharaoh sent and called for Moses and Aaron, and he said to them, I have sinned this time. The Lord is righteous, and my people and I are wicked. Entreat the Lord that there may be no more mighty thundering and hail, for it is enough. I will let you go, and you shall stay no longer. So Moses said to him, as soon as I have gone out of the city, I will spread out my hands to the Lord, and the thunder will cease, and there will be no more hail, that you may know that the earth is the Lord's. Pharaoh got the point. He was willing to let the people go. But was his decision real repentance? Was it a lasting decision from a changed heart? Moses didn't think so. Verse 30. But as for you and your servants, I know you will not yet fear the Lord. True repentance is a complete change in behavior. The word for repentance means an about face. It is a change of heart that results in a change of behavior. Moses said, I don't think your heart has changed. I know that you will not yet fear the Lord God. Pharaoh was still worshiping the false Egyptian gods. But he was getting a healthy dose of godly fear for the God of the Hebrews. And it was so much that some of the Egyptians believed and probably went with the Hebrews when they left Egypt. But not all of them believed. 33. So Moses went out of the city from Pharaoh and spread out his hands to the Lord, and then the thunder and the hail ceased, and the rain was not poured on the earth. God stopped it. And when Pharaoh saw that the rain, the hail, and the thunder had ceased, he sinned yet more. He hardened his heart, he and his servants. So the heart of Pharaoh was hard. Neither would he let the children of Israel go as the Lord had spoken by Moses. Moses went out of the city. Moses was not afraid of the hail and the fire. He knew God better than that. He knew God would hear his prayer. God would see him. God would guard him. He went out and he asked the Lord to stop the hail, and God did. John Wesley said, peace with God makes men thunderproof, for it is the voice of their Father. Friends, it is the devil who wants us to be afraid. It is the devil who wants us to fear. The only fear that's great fear is the fear of God. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. It is the fear of God. Some people are afraid of everything. And Satan wants to enslave us and put us in bondage with fear. The Bible says, you have not received the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. It's trusting God. Moses trusted God. When we trust God, he will take care of us. And Moses went out of the city and he brought his hands to the Lord, an outward expression of humble assurance. He humbled himself before the Lord. Moses' faith had become complete. He completely trusted God. He prevailed with God. God would work through Moses and glorify himself through Moses. But Moses could not change Pharaoh's heart. As he said, Pharaoh did not yet fear God. Pharaoh hardened his heart. And when Pharaoh saw that the rain, the hail, and the thunder ceased, he sinned yet more and he hardened his heart. He and his servants. He led them his servants to harden their hearts. Friends, be careful what kind of witness you give to this world. Be careful those people that are watching you. Maybe the little eyes that are watching what you do. There is a big responsibility God gives to moms and dads raising their children, and granddads and grandmoms raising their grandchildren. There's a big responsibility. I know some dads that are teaching their children the wrong thing. They're not teaching them respect for God. They're teaching them to defy the living God. That God is not important in their lives. Many parents are teaching their children that today, and they are going to pay a price for that, I believe. I see this happening with men today. There is not much fear of God before the eyes of men, but if there is any fear, it is only temporary fear. People turn to God for a moment when the fiery hell is falling. They turn during times of crisis. They turn during times of need. They turn during times of pain. But when it's over, they turn back away from God and go back to their old ways of exalting themselves. That's exactly what Pharaoh's doing. One day the defiance is going to be over. One day God will have the last word. One day the day of grace will pass. One day people will realize who really does hold their lives. And that day they will be sorry that they did not put their lives in the hands of Almighty God. Friends, He can do anything. We need Him. I realize I need Him more and more. Life is getting more and more hectic and complicated and dangerous. We need a place to hide. We need a place of comfort and strength, don't we? That place is with the One who can send fire on the wicked and grant forgiveness to the weary. And we will not come to Him unless we have reached that point in our lives where we will let go of the other gods and we will long for the grace of our Almighty God. We need His power and forgiveness. It would take a few more plagues for Pharaoh to realize that in his life. You see, God can do anything. God can even break us and force us to obey Him. But He will not do that. He will not. Instead, He works to show us the error of our ways and show us His grace so that we will freely and deliberately turn to Him by faith. This is why one of the reasons our world is in such a mess today. Paul said there was going to be a day when people would try to find teachers. They would heap to themselves. They would just gather as many as they could. Teachers that would pervert the truth. That would call wrong what is wrong right and what is right wrong. Paul said there's going to be a day in the last days before Jesus comes. And people are going to hunger for a lie. They will turn away from the truth. They don't want to hear what is right. It's like the person I remember visiting the church one day and left and said to me, I'm not coming back, Pastor, because I don't want anybody telling me what is right and not right. That's my job. That's your job. We might make God known to this world. That we might declare His word among the nation. Remember the Great Commission? Jesus said, now you go, all power is mine, heaven and earth, I'm the Almighty God. Now you go and teach all nations. What are we supposed to teach them? What He said. This world needs to know what God said. We need His power, we need His forgiveness, and Pharaoh just didn't deal with you, but he would. God would make sure he got the message. Now how about your life? What would it take for you to recognize that God is God and that He must be the sovereign ruler of your life? Would it take a miracle? Would it take a loss? When Pharaoh saw all that fire running throughout his land, and his kingdom under attack, and he was powerless to do anything about it. When he saw his helplessness, he turned to God temporarily. But that was not enough for God, a temporary turn. Jesus said, He who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of heaven. It takes a devoted heart. It takes someone who really repents and who truly follows Jesus. And the proof is in what you do after you say the words. Pharaoh said, okay, let them go. And then Pharaoh said, no, you can't go. The proof of our repentance and our faith in God and that He is the sovereign ruler of our lives is in the actions, not just the words. Be doers of the word and not just hearers only. A pastor was traveling on a bus down Bumpy Road. And sitting next to him was a college student who noticed that the pastor was reading his Bible, and the minister asked, are you spiritually ready, young man, for the temptations you will face in college? I don't have a problem with temptation, the young man told the minister. I have strong willpower. Well, the minister took a pencil from his pocket and he said, you know, I can make this pencil stand up on the cover of this Bible even though the bus ride is bumpy. And the young man said, I'll believe it when I see it. I don't think you can do it. Well, look, I'm doing it, he replied as the young man watched. And yeah, but you didn't tell me you were going to be holding the pencil up in your hand. I didn't have to tell you, the pastor remarked. Have you ever seen a pencil stand up on its own without someone holding it? The minister then let go of the pencil and it instantly fell over. The only reason you stand, he said, is because God holds you with His hand. Friends, remember that. If God were to remove His hand as protecting grace, we would immediately fall into sin. Humility is depending completely on God, realizing that He upholds us by His grace. Are you like Pharaoh, only turning to God when things are beyond your control, when the fiery hail is falling? Then you turn back to your own way when it stops? That's what Pharaoh did. He gave in to God, then he turned back when things were better. What we really need is that personal love and devotion to God, where we are completely surrendered to God and depending on Him, putting every moment of our lives in His hand, so that He is holding us. So that He is holding us. And our lives are spent guided by Him, being lived out for His glory. That's where we'll find the greatest joy in life and the calm assurance through every fiery life. Amen? Listen. You're here today, you are in the hand of God, and you're being held by Him. He's going to hold you, He's got a grip on you, and if you'll stay there, that's going to get you all the way through this life and into heaven. And nothing's going to be able to take you away from Him. Maybe you're like that pencil on that Bible, it's there, but it's going to fall, and it does fall over and over again. Maybe it's because you're not really and truly repenting of that thing that's holding you back, that thing that's captured your attention, and you're not placing your total self in the hand of God. Why don't you do that today? Why don't you stop letting the devil use things to defeat you? Why don't you stop letting him keep you away from God? That's the way Pharaoh was. Run to God and try in a fiery trial and run away, turn away when it's over. That's not true faith. That's not a true personal relationship with God. Run to the Lord and stay there. Maybe you're here and you need that relationship with God. For you, it's not personal. It's in your head. It's not in your heart. You know about God, but you don't have His peace. Well, He has to come into your life. He will come in if you'll trust Him, if you'll believe in Jesus. That's why Jesus died on the cross to pay for your sins. If Jesus hadn't done it, you would have had to been punished forever. In fact, if you choose another Savior, you try to do it yourself, you'll still face the fiery judgment of God. It takes faith in Jesus. You have to believe and receive Him as your only Savior. You can. Why don't you pray and say, "Dear Jesus, I'm sorry for my sins. I believe in You. I believe You died on the cross and rose from the dead. I believe You paid for me with Your own blood. And I ask You to forgive me for all of my sins. Forgive me for all of my sins, Jesus. I cast them all on You at the cross. I pray that You'll wash me clean. Pray that You'll forgive me. I pray that You'll come into my heart and be my Savior forever. Right now, Jesus, I receive You as my personal Savior. And I want to follow You the rest of my life." If you prayed that prayer, that's the greatest prayer you could pray. But was it real? We'll see. After you leave this place, what will you do? Stay with the Lord. On our welcome center, there's some books that will help you grow as a Christian. Some will be there after the service to help you. If you just walk outside one of those books that the pastor gave me, I accepted Jesus as my Savior. And I want one of the books, they'll give it to you. Maybe you won't need to join this church and be a member here. God's brought you here. Just be obedient to them. Just do what God wants. Lord Jesus, whatever You want to do with us, I pray that every one of us would just say, "Here I am, Lord. You do what You want." Father, I pray that You will raise us up above the fiery trials. Get us through those trials. And Lord, help us be strong in You to let the world know just how strong You are. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.